didn't receive any of these two recognitions. So actually, the fake was really more real than the original, okay? And actually, the organizer of the originals came to the conference at the Cultural Commission of the Senate, and we spotted them in the audience, and we brought a microphone to them, and we told them, okay, how come you're here? And they said to study the competition, okay? So what happened is that a fake was transformed into a real cultural institution, okay? Because it was building up, the thing was building up a lot, so we actually built what is turning out to be a fake cultural institution enacting real cultural practices, which is a wonderful and powerful situation, okay? Because being a fake, you don't have to bear with many of the things which ordinary cultural institution has to bear, legality, bureaucracy, and things like that. Because actually it doesn't exist, okay? So who do you sue? It's obvious that they sue me and her, because we are the ones who open, but we can play with that, okay? We can play a lot with that. And so what is happening is just that we created a fake cultural institution which is working now, enacting real cultural policies. In fact, the first thing that happened is that the year afterwards, the Fondazione Roma Europa was actually forced. It didn't turn out that nice for them. They were actually forced to change the second edition of the competition, which was actually like our version of the competition. It was a competition. The next year of the original competition was a competition on Remix. Well, which is and on Creative Commons licenses, so it had to change policies. And to make a long story short, we moved on into what we were doing, okay? Because we felt that we had something that was actually very useful for lots of people, and that was also very usable to achieve results. And so what we did was to make a next step. The next step was to gather many of the people who were supporting us, and we created a book, but not to create a book. Actually, it's a very important thing that this book exists, because it in a way collected all the forces that that were helping us out and making this possible.
And it's also symbolical, because you know, you made a book.
Yes, like... that's just about it. So we made this book actually to gather all the people that were supporting us and helping us and making this true, actually. So there's loads of interesting people in there, starting from our friend Bruce Sterling, which made a lovely preface to the book. And you'll find loads of it. For example, we didn't write on the book. We just collected all the contributions and put them in a sequence. And the book is also very important for us, because it describes in multiple ways, so the book is a platform as well, it describes in multiple ways that same discourse which we were making in the beginning, describing a possibility through multiple points of view. So in here you will find it's divided in two parts, a theoretical one and let's call it art catalog, but it's a bit more than that on the second part of the book. And they are all discussing possibilities of creating additional parts of reality. The slogan is Remix the World, Reinvent Reality, but it's a slogan that means that we can actually use multiple techniques to enact new parts of reality, autonomous, independent. So there are academics, journalists, even some politicians. Then in the second part there are artists, designers, architects, each one of them describing their practice for their invention of reality. This book, so this is the book that describes all the practices, or at least some of them, which we know we can use to reinvent reality using critical practices and autonomous and freely available technologies.